Lost and won.
That will be air, the set of sun.
Where the place?
Upon the heath. There to meet with
Macbeth!
Fair is high, and foul is fair. Hover the bow and fill the air. Fair is high, and foul is fair. Hover the bow and fill the air. Fair is high, and foul is fair.
The sergeant, who like a good and hardy soldier fought against my captivity. Hail, brave friend! Say to the king the knowledge of the broil is not outsleeving.
Doubtful it stood, as two spent swimmers that do cling together choke in their hearts. The merciless MacDowell from the Western Isle is supplied, and fortune on his damned quarrel smiling showed like a rebel's horn. But all is too weak. For brave Macbeth, well he deserves that name, disdaining fortune with brandished steel, which smoked with bloody execution. He carved out his passage until he faced the slave, which ne'er shook hands nor bade farewell him, until he unseamed him from knave to chops, fixed his head upon our battlements.
Oh, valiant cousin, worthy gentleman.
Oh, Mark, King of Scotland, Mark! If I say sooth, I must report that they were as cannons overcharged with double cracks. So they doubly, redoubled stroke upon the foes. Except they meant to bathe in those reeking wounds or memorize another Golgotha. I cannot say. My wounds, they cried for help.
As well thy wounds' words become thee as thy wounds. They smack of honor both. Go get him, surgeons. Now, who comes here?
The worthy Thane of Ross.
What haste looks through his eyes? So should they look one that speaks things strange.
God save the king.
Whence camest thou, worthy Thane?
From Fife, great king, where the Norwegian banners flout the sky and fan our people cold. Norway himself, with terrible numbers, assisted by that most disloyal traitor, the Thane of Cawdor, began a dismal conflict, till that the dauntless Macbeth confronted him with self-comparisons, point against point rebellious, arm against arm, curbing his lavish spirit. And to conclude, the victory fell on us!
Great happiness! No more that Thane of Cawdor shall deceive our bosom interest. Go, pronounce his present death, and with his former title, greet Macbeth.
I'll see it done.
What he hath lost, noble Macbeth hath won.
Where hast thou been, sister?
Killing swine.
Sister, wert thou?
Show me, show me. Here I have a pilot's thumb. Breakfast homewards he did come. a drum, Macbeth doth come.
So foul and fair a day I have not seen.
How far is it called the forest? What are these? So withered and so wild in their attire that they look not like the inhabitants of the earth, yet are on it. Live you? Or are you what the man may question? You seem to understand me. My ancient ones, her chappy finger laying upon her skinny lips. You should be women, yet your beards forbid me to interpret that you are so.
Speak if you can. What are you?
All hail, Macbeth. Hail to thee, Thane of Blums.
All hail, Macbeth. Hail to thee, Thane of Cawdor.
All hail, Macbeth. Thou shalt be king hereafter.
Good sir, why do you start and seem to fear things that do sound so fair? In the name of truth, are ye fantastical, or that indeed which outwardly ye show? My noble partner you greet with present grace and great prediction of noble having, of royal hope that he seems wrapped withal. To me, you speak not. If you can look into the seeds of time and say which grains will grow and which will not, speak then to me, who neither beg nor feel your favors nor your hate.
Hail, 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 lesser than Macbeth and greater,
not so happy, yet much happier.
Thou shalt get kings though thou be none. So all hail Macbeth and Banquo.
Banquo and Macbeth. All hail.
Stay, you imperfect speakers. Tell me more. By my father's death, I know I am Thane of Glamis, but how of Cawdor? The Thane of Cawdor lives, a prosperous gentleman. And to be king stands not within the prospect of belief. Say from whence you owe this strange intelligence. But why you stop away with such prophetic greeting? Speak, I charge you.
Whither did they vanish?
Into the air. And what seemed corporal melted as breath into the wind. Would they had stayed?
Were such things here as we do speak about, or have we eaten on the insane root that takes reason prisoner?
Your children shall be kings.
You shall be king.
And Thane of Cawdor, too. When is that so?
To the selfsame tune and words. Who's there?
The king hath happily received, Macbeth, the news of thy success.
We are sent to give thee from our worthy master's thanks, and to herald thee into his sight, not pay thee.
And for an earnest of a greater reward, he bade me from him call thee the Thane of Cawdor, in which addition, hail, most worthy Thane, for it is thine.
What? Can the devil speak true?
The Thane of Cawdor lives. Why do you dress me in borrowed robes?
Who is it Thane lives yet, but under heavy judgment bears that life, which he deserves to lose? but treason's capital confessed and proof have overthrown him.
Glamis, and Thane of Cawdor, the greatest to come. Thanks for your pains. Do you not hope your children shall be king? When those that gave the Thane of Cawdor to me promised no less to them.
That trusted home may yet enkindle you under the crown besides the Thane of Cawdor. But 'tis strange, and oftentimes, to win us to our harm, the instruments of darkness tell us truths, win us with honest trifles to betray us in deepest consequence. Cousins, a word, I pray you.
Two truths are told as happy prologues to the swelling act of the imperial theme. I thank you, gentlemen. This supernatural soliciting cannot be ill, cannot be good. If ill, why hath it given the earnest of success, commencing in the truth, I am Thane of Cawdor? If good, why do I yield to that suggestion whose horrid image doth unfix my hair and make my seated heart knock at my ribs against the use of nature? Present fears are less than horrible imaginings. My thought, whose murder yet is but fantastical, shakes so my single state of man, but function is smothered in surmise, and nothing is but what is not.
Look how our partner's wrapped.
If chance will have me king, why, chance may crown me without my stir. Come what come may, time in the hour runs through the roughest day.
Worthy Macbeth, we stay upon your leisure.
Give me your favor. My dull brain was wrought with things forgotten. Come, let's court the king. Think of what hath chanced, and that more time, the interim having waited, let us speak our free hearts, one to other.
Very gladly.
Till then, enough. Come, friend.
Are not those in commission yet returned?
My liege, they are not yet come back, but I have spoke with one that saw him die, who did report that very frankly he confessed his treasons, implored your highness' pardon, and set forth a deep repentance. Nothing in his life became him like believing it. He died as one that had been studied in his death to throw away the dearest thing he owed, as 'twere a careless trifle.
There's no art to find the mind's construction in the face. He was a gentleman on whom I built an absolute trust. Oh, worthiest cousin, the sin of my ingratitude even now was heavy on me. Would that thou had less deserved, that the proportion both of thanks and payment might have been mine. Only I have left to say, more is thy due than more than all can pay.
The service and the loyalty I owe, in doing it, pays itself. Your highness' part is to receive our duties. Our duties are to your throne and state, children and servants, which do but what they should in doing everything safe toward your love and honor.
Welcome hither. I have begun to plant thee, and will labor to make thee full of growing. Noble Banquo, thou hast no less deserved, nor must be known no less to have done so. Let me enfold thee and hold thee to my heart.
There if I grow, the harvest is your own.
My plenteous joys, wanton in fullness, except hide themselves in drops of sorrow. Sons, kinsmen, thanes, and you whose places are the nearest, know, we will establish our estate upon our eldest, Malcolm, whom we name here after the Prince of Cumberland, which honor must not unaccompanied invest him only, but signs of nobleness like stars shall shine on all deservers. From hence to Inverness, and bind us further to you.
The rest is labor which is not used for you. I'll be the harbinger, and make joyful the hearing of my wife with your approach. So humbly take my leave.
My worthy Cawdor.
The Prince of Cumberland. That is a step on which I must fall down. Or leap. For in my way it lies. Stars, hide your fires. Let not light see my black and deep desires. The eye wink at the hand. Yet let that be which the eye fears when it is done to see.
True, worthy Banquo, he is full so valiant, and in his commendations I am fed. It is a banquet to me. Let's after him, whose care has gone before to bid us welcome. It is a peerless kinsman.
Success, and I have learned by the perfectest report they have more in them than mortal knowledge.
When I burned in desire to question them further, they made themselves air, into which they vanished. Whilst I stood rapt in the wonder of it, came missives from the king, who all hailed me Thane of Cawdor, by which title before these weird sisters saluted me and referred me to the coming on of time with hail, king that shalt be. This have I thought good to deliver thee, my dearest partner of greatness, that thou mightst not lose the dues of rejoicing by being ignorant of what greatness is promised thee. Lay it to thy heart, and farewell. Glamis thou art, and Cawdor, and shalt be what thou art promised. Yet I do fear thy nature. It is too full of the milk of human kindness to catch the nearest way. Thou wouldst be great, art not without ambition, but without the illness that should attend it. What thou wouldst thou highly, thou wouldst thou holily, wouldst not play false, and yet wouldst wrongly win. Thou must have, great Glamis, that which cries thus thou must do if thou have it. That which rather thou dost fear to do than wishest should be undone. Hie thee hither, that I may pour my spirit into thine ear, and chastise thee with the valor of my tongue, all that impedes thee from the golden round, which fate and metaphysical aid doth seem to have thee crowned withal.
What is your tidings?
The king comes here tonight.
Thou art mad to say it. Is not thy master with him, who, were it so, would have informed for preparation?
So please you, 'tis true, our thane is coming. One of the gentlemen had the speed of him, which, who, almost dead for breath, had scarcely more than to deliver his message.
Give him tending, for he brings great news. The raven himself is hoarse that croaks the fatal entrance of Duncan under my battlements. Come, you spirits that tend on mortal thoughts, unsex me here and fill me from the crown to the toe top full of direst cruelty. Make thick my blood. Stop up the access and passage to remorse, so that no compunctious visitings of nature shall shake my fell purpose, nor make peace between the effect and it. Come to my woman's breast, and take my milk for gall, you murdering ministers, wherever in your sightless substances you wait on nature's mischief. Come, thick night, and pour thee in the dunnest smokes of hell, that my keen knife see not the wound it makes, nor heaven peek through the blankets of the dark to cry, hold, hold! Great Glamis, worthy Cawdor, greater than both by the all hail thereafter. Thy letters have transported me beyond this ignorant present, and I can feel the future in the instant.
My dearest wife, Duncan comes here tonight.
And when goes hence?
Tomorrow, as he purposes.
Oh, never shall sun man morrow see.
Your face, my thing, is as a book where men may read strange matters. To beguile the time, look like the time, and welcome in your eye, your hand, your tongue. Look like the innocent flower, but be the serpent under it. He that comes must be provided for. And you shall put tonight's great business into my dispatch, which shall, to all our nights and days to come, give solely sovereign sway and masterdom.
We will speak further.
Only look up clear, to alter favor ever is to fear.
Leave all the rest to me.
Recommends itself unto our gentle senses. Oh, see, our honored hostess. The love that follows us sometime is our trouble, which still we thank as love. Herein I teach you how you shall be God yield us for your pains and thank us for your troubles.
All our service, in every point twice done, and then done double. We're poor and single business to contend against those honors deep and broad wherein your majesty loads our house.
Where's the Thane of Cawdor? We coursed him at the heels and had a purpose to be his purveyor, but he rides well. And his great love, sharp as his spur, hath hauled him to his home before us. Fair and noble hostess, we are your guest tonight.
Our servants ever have theirs themselves, and what is theirs in compt? To make audit at your highness's pleasure, still to return their own.
Give me your hand. Conduct me to mine host. We love him highly and shall continue our graces towards him. By your leave, hostess.
If it were done, when 'tis done, then 'twere well it were done quickly. If the assassination could trammel up the consequence and catch with his surcease success, if but this blow might be the be-all and the end-all here, but here, upon this bank and shoal of time, we jump the life to come. But in these cases, we still have judgment here, that we but teach bloody instructions, which being taught, return to plague the inventor. This even-handed justice commends the ingredients of our poisoned chalice to our own lips. He's here in double trust. First, as I am his kinsman and his subject, strong both against the deed. Then is his host, who should against his murderer shut the door, not bear the knife myself. Besides, this Duncan hath borne his faculties so meek, hath been so clear in his great office, that his virtues will plead like angels, trumpet-tongued against the deep damnation of his taking off. And pity, like a naked newborn babe striding the blast, for heaven's cherubim horsed upon the sightless couriers of the air, shall blow the horrid deed in every eye. The tears shall drown the wind. I have no spur to prick the sides of my intent, but only vaulting ambition, which o'erleaps itself and falls on the others. And now what news?
He hath almost supped. Why have you left the chamber?
Hath he asked for me?
No, you not, he has.
We will proceed no further in this business. He hath honored me of late, and I have bought golden opinions from all sorts of people, which should be worn now in their newest gloss, not cast aside so soon.
Was the hope drunk wherein you dressed yourself? Hath it slept since? And wakes it now to look so green and pale at what it did so freely. From this time such I account thy love. Art thou afeard to be the same in thine own act and valor as thou art in desire? Wouldst thou have that which thou esteems the ornament of life, and live a coward in thine own esteem, letting I dare not wait upon I will, like the poor cat in the attic.
Pretty peace! I dare do all that may become a man. Who dares do more is none.
What feast was it then that made you break this enterprise to me? When you darest do it, then you were a man. and to be more than what you were, you would be so much more than man. Nor time nor place did that inhere, and yet you would make both. They have made themselves, and that their fitness does unmake you. I have given suck, and I know how tender 'tis to love the babe that milks me. I would, while it was smiling in my face, have plucked my nipple from his boneless gums and dashed his brains out, had he so sworn as you had done to this!
If we should fail.
We fail? But screw your courage that is taking place, and we'll not fail. When Duncan is asleep, would you rather his day's hard journey must soundly invite him? His two chamberlains will I, with wine and wassail, so convince that memory, the warder of the brain, shall be but a fume, and the receipt of reason a limbeck only, when in swinish sleep their drenching natures lay as in a death. What cannot you and I perform upon the unguarded Duncan? What not put upon his spongy officers, who will bear the guilt of our great quell?
Bring forth men, children only, for thy undaunted metal should compose nothing but males. Will it not be received when we have marked with blood those sleepy two of his own chamber, and used their hairy daggers, that they have done it?
Who dares receive it other, as we will make our griefs and clamor roar upon his death?
I am settled. And bend up each corporal agent to this terrible feat. Away. Mock the time with fairest show. False face must hide what the false heart doth know.
How goes the night, boy?
The moon is down. I have not heard the clock.
And she goes down at 12.
I take his waiter, sir.
Hold. Take my dagger. There's husbandry in the heavens. Their candles are all out. Here, take thee that too. A heavy summons lies like lead upon me, yet I would not sleep. Merciful powers, restrain in me the cursed thoughts that nature gives way to in repose. Give me my blade. Who's there?
A friend.
What, sir? Not yet at rest?
The king's abed. He hath been an unusual pleasure. Oh, and this diamond. He greets your wife withal, by the name of most kind hostess, and shut up in measureless content.
Being unprepared, our will became the servant to defect, which else should free have wrought.
All's well. I dreamt last night of the three weird sisters. To you they shone some truth.
I think not of them. Yet, when we could entreat an hour to serve, we would spend it in some words upon that business, if you would grant the time.
At your kindest leisure.
If you shall cleave to my intent when 'tis, it shall make honor for you.
So that I lose none in seeking to augment it, but that I keep my bosom franchised and allegiance clear, I shall be counseled.
Good repose the while.
Thank you, sir. The like to you.
Go. Bid their mistress. When my drink is ready, she strike upon the bell. Get thee to bed. The dagger I see before me, the handle toward my hand. Come, let me cut thee. I have thee not, yet I see thee still. Art thou not, fatal vision? Sensible to feeling as to sight? Or art thou but a dagger of the mind? A false creation proceeding from the heat-oppressed brain? I see thee yet. And on my blade, in form as palpable as this which now I draw, thou marshalest me the way that I was going. Such an instrument I was to use. Mine eyes are made the fools of the other senses, or else worth all the rest. I see thee still. And on my blade and dudgeon, guts of blood, which was not so before. There's no such thing. It is the bloody business which informs thus to mine eyes. Now o'er the one half world, nature seems dead. And wicked dreams abuse the curtain's sleep. Witchcraft celebrates pale Hecate's offerings. And withered murder, alarmed by his sentinel, the wolf, whose howls his watch, thus, with his stealthy pace,
with Tarquin's ravishing stride, towards his design, moves like a ghost. Thy sure and firm setteth, hear not my steps which way they walk, for fear thy very stones prate of my whereabouts, and take the present horror from the time which now suits with it. Whilst I threat he lives, words to the heat of deeds too cold breath gives. I go, and it is done. The bell invites me. Hear it not, Duncan, for it is a knell that summons thee to heaven or to hell.
That which hath made them drunk hath made me bold. What hath quenched them hath given me fire. Peace. It was the owl that shrieked, the fatal bellman that gives the sternest good night. He is about it. The doors are open. The surfeited grooms do mock their charge with snores. I have drugged their possets, that death and nature do contend against them, whether they live or die.
Who's there? Ah! Oh!
Alack! I am afraid they have awakened, and 'tis not done. The attempt and not the deed confounds us. I laid the daggers ready. He could not have missed them. Had he not resembled my father as he slept, I would have done it. My husband!
I have done the deed. Didst thou not hear a noise?
I heard the owl shriek and the crickets cry. Did not you speak?
When?
Now!
As I descended.
Hi!
Hark! Who lies in the second chamber?
Donalbain!
Oh, this is a sorry sight.
A foolish thought to say a sorry sight!
As one did laugh in his sleep, and one cried murder, I stood and heard them. But they did say their prayers, and address them again to sleep.
There are two, lodged together.
One cried, God bless us, and amen the other. As they had seen me with these hangman's hands. Listening their fear, I could not say amen when they did say, God bless us.
Consider it not so deeply.
But wherefore could not I pronounce amen? I had most need of blessing. And amen stuck in my throat.
These things must not be thought after these ways, else it will make us mad.
Methought I heard a voice cry, sleep no more. Macbeth of murder, sleep. The innocent sleep. Sleep that knits up the raveled sleeve of care. The death of each day's life. Sore labor's bath. Balm of hurt mind. Great nature's second course. chief nourisher in life's feast.
What do you mean?
Still cried all the house. Glams have murdered sleep. Therefore, Cawdor shall sleep no more. Macbeth shall sleep no more.
Who was it that thus cried?
Why, worthy thing, you do unbend your noble strength to think so brain sickly of things. Go, get some water, and wash this filthy witness from your hands. Why did you bring the daggers from the place? They must lie there. Go, carry them, and smear the sleeping grooms with blood.
I'll go no more. I'm afraid to think what I have done. Look on it again, I dare not.
Infirm of purpose! Give me the daggers! The sleeping and the dead are but as pictures! 'Tis the eye of childhood that fears a painted devil. If he do bleed, I'll spear the faces of the grooms withal. For it must seem their guilt.
Whence is that knocking? How is it with me? That every noise appalls me. What hands are here? I may pluck out mine eyes. Will all great Neptune's ocean wash this blood clean from my hand? No. This my hand will rather the multitudinous seas incarnadine, making the green one red.
My hands are of your color, but I shame to wear a heart so white. There's a knocking at the south entry. Retire we to our chamber. A little water clears us up the steed. How easy is it then? Your constancy has left you unattended. We're knocking. Get on your gown, lest occasion call upon us and find us to be watchers. Be not lost so poorly in your thoughts.
To know my deeds, would best not know myself. Wake, Duncan, with thy knocking. I would thou couldst.
Here's a knocking indeed. If a man were porter of Hellgate, he should get out, turn the key. Knock, knock, knock. Who's there in the name of Beelzebub? Here's a farmer who hanged himself on the expectation of plenty. Come in time, have napkins in our batch you. Here you'll sweat for it. Knock, knock. Who's there in the other devil's name? Faith. Here's an equivocator who could swear in both the scales against either scale. Who committed treason enough for God's sake, yet could not equivocate to heaven. Oh, come in, equivocator. Knock, 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 who's there? Faith. Here's an English tailor
come hither for stealing out of a French hose. Ha! 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 Come in, tailor. Here, you may roast your goose. Knock! Knock! Never act quiet! What are you? But this place is too cold for hell. I'll dare the porter it no further. I had thought to have let in some of all professions that go the primrose way to the everlasting bonfire. Anon. Anon! I pray you, remember the porter.
Was it so late, friend, that you went to bed that you do lie so late?
Faith, sir, we were carousing till the second cock. And drink, sir, is a great provoker of three things.
What three things does drink especially provoke?
Mary, sir, nose painting, sleep, and urine. Lechery, sir, it provokes and unprovokes. Provokes the desire, but takes away the performance. Therefore, much drink may be said to be an equivocator with lechery. It makes him and it mars him. It sets him on and takes him off. Persuades him and disheartens him. Makes him stand to and not stand to. In conclusion, equivocates him in his sleep and, giving him the lie, leaves him.
I believe drink gave thee the lie last night.
That it did, sir, in the very throat of me. But I requited him for his lie, and I think being too strong for him, though he took up my legs sometime, yet I made a shift to cast him.
Is thy master stirring? Our knocking has awaked him. Here he comes.
Good morrow, noble sir.
Good morrow all.
Is the king stirring, worthy thane?
Not yet.
He did command me to call timely on him. I have almost slipped the hour.
I'll bring you to him.
I know this is a joyful trouble to you, but yet, 'tis one.
The labor we delight in, physic's pain. This is the door.
I'll make so bold to call, for 'tis my limited service.
Goes the king hence today?
He does. He did appoint so.
The night has been unruly. Where we lay, our chimneys were blown down, and, as they say, lamentings turn to the air, strange screams of death, and prophesying with accents terrible of dire combustion and confused events new hatched to the woeful time. The obscure bird clamored the livelong night. Some say the earth was feverous and did shake.
'Twas a rough night.
My young remembrance cannot parallel a fellow to it.
Oh, horror! Horror, horror! Tongue nor heart cannot conceive nor name thee.
But what's the matter?
Confusion now hath made this masterpiece. Most sacrilegious murder hath broke open the Lord's anointed temple and stole thence the life of the building.
What is it you say? The life?
Mean you his majesty?
Approach the chamber and destroy your sights with a new gorgon. Do not bid me speak. See and then speak yourself. Awake! Awake! Ring the alarum bell! Murder! Treason! Banquo! Donalbain! Malcolm! Awake! Shake off this downy sleep death's counterfeit and look on death itself! Up! Up and see the great doom's image! Banquo! Malcolm! As from your graves rise up and walk like sprites to countenance this horror! Ring the bell!
What's the business that such a hideous trumpet calls to parley the sleepers of this house? Speak, speak!
Oh, gentle lady, 'tis not for you to hear what I can speak. The repetition in a woman's ear would murder as it fell. Banquo, Banquo. Our royal master's murdered.
Oh, alas! In our house?
Too cruel anywhere. Oh, dear Duff, I prithee contradict thyself and say it is not so.
Had I but died an hour before this chance, I had lived a blessed time. For from this instant, nothing serious in mortality. All is but toys. Grace and renown are dead. The wine of life is drawn.
What is amiss?
You are, and do not know it. The spring, the head, the fountain of your blood is stopped. The very source of it is stopped.
Your royal father's murdered.
By who?
Those of his chamber seem to have done it. Their hands and faces were badged with blood. So were their daggers, which unwiped we found upon their pillows. They stared and seemed to be distracted. No man's life should be trusted with them.
Yes, I do repent me of my fury that I did kill them.
Wherefore did you so?
Who can be wise, amazed, temperate and furious, loyal and neutral in a moment? No man! The violent expedition of my love outran the pause of reason. Here lay Duncan, his silver skin laced with his golden blood, and his gashed stabs looked like a breach in nature for ruin's wasteful entrance. There the murderers, steeped in the colors of their trade, their daggers unmannerly breached with gore. Who could refrain that had a heart to love, and in his heart courage to make his love known?
Help me hence.
Oh. Look to the lady.
Why do we hold our tongues that most may claim this argument for ours? What should be spoken here where our fate hid in an auger hole may rush and seize us? Let's away. Our tears are not yet brewed, nor our strong sorrow upon the foot of motion.
Look to the lady. And when we have our naked frailties hid that suffer an exposure, let us meet and question this most bloody piece of work to know it further. Fear and scruples shake us. In the great hand of God I stand, and thence against the undivulged pretense I fight of treasonous malice.
So do I.
So all.
Let's put on manly readiness and meet in the hall together.
Well contented.
Well contented.
What will you do? Let's not consort with them. To show an unfelt sorrow is the office that a false man does easy. I'll to England.
To Ireland, I. Our separated fortune shall keep us both the safer. Where we are, there's daggers in men's smiles. The near in blood, the nearer bloody.
This murderous shaft that's shot hath not yet lighted, and our safest way is to avoid the aim. Therefore, to horse, and let us not be dainty of leave-taking, but shift away.
Thank you.
remember well. Within the volume of which time I have seen hours dreadful and things strange. But this sore night hath trifled former known.
Ah, good sister, thou seest the heavens, as troubled with man's act, threaten his bloody stage. By the clock 'tis day, yet dark night strangles the traveling lamp. Is night's predominance or the day's shame that darkness does the face of earth entomb when living light should kiss it?
'Tis unnatural, even as the deed is done. On Tuesday last, a falcon, towering in its pride of place, was by a mousing owl hawked at and killed.
And Duncan's horses? A thing most strange and certain. Beauteous and swift, the minions of their race, turned wild in nature, flung out, broke their stalls, contending against obedience as they would make war with mankind.
'Tis said they ate each other.
They did so, to the amazement of mine eyes that looked upon it. Here comes the good Macduff. How goes the world, sir, now?
Why, see you not?
Is known who did this more than bloody deed?
Why, those that Macbeth hath slain.
Alas, the day! What good could they pretend?
They were suborned. Malcolm and Donald Bane, the king's two sons, have stolen away and fled, which puts upon them suspicion of the deed.
Against nature still, thriftless ambition, that wilt raven up thine own life's means, then 'tis most like the sovereignty will fall upon Macbeth.
He has already been named, and gone to Scone to be invested.
Where is Duncan's body?
Carried to Combkill, sacred storehouse of his predecessors and guardians of their bones.
Will you to Scone?
No, cousin. Will to Fife?
Well, I will thither.
May you see things well done there. Adieu. Thus our old robes sit easier than our new.
Farewell, sister.
God's benison go with you, and with those that will make good of bad and friends of those.
Thou hast it now. King, Cotter, Glams, all as the weird women promised. Oh, and I fear thou playest most foully for it. Yet it was said it should not stand in thy posterity, but that myself should be the root and father of many kings. If there come truth from them, as upon thee, Macbeth, their speeches shine, why, by the verities on thee made good, may they not be my oracles as well, and set me up in hope. But hush, no more.
Here's our chief guest.
Had it been forgotten, it would have been as a gap in our great feast, and all things unbecoming.
Tonight we hold a solemn supper, sir, and I'll request your presence.
Let your highness command upon me, to the which my duties are with a most indissoluble tie, forever knit.
Ride you this afternoon.
Aye, my good lord.
We should have else desired your good advice in this day's council, but we'll take tomorrow. Is it far you ride?
As far, my lord, as will fill up the time twixt this and supper. Go not my horse the better. I must become a borrower over the night for an hour or twain.
Fail not our feast.
My lord, I will not.
We hear our bloody cousins are bestowed in England and in Ireland, not confessing their cruel parricide, filling their hearers with strange invention. But of that tomorrow. Hie you to horse till you return tonight. Ah, goes Fleance with you.
Aye, my good lord. Our time does call upon us.
I wish your horses swift and sure of foot, and so I do commend you to their back. Let every man be master of his time till 7 at night. To make society this sweeter welcome, we will keep ourselves till supper time alone. Well then, God be with you. Sirrah, a word with you. Attend those men our pleasure.
Now, my lord, without the palace gates.
Bring them before us.
To be thus is nothing. But to be safely thus.
Our fears in Dyko stick deep, and in his royalty of nature reigns that which would be feared. 'Tis much he dares, and to that dauntless temper of his mind, he hath a wisdom that doth guide his valor to act in safety. There is none but he whose being I do fear, and under him my genius is rebuked. He chid the sisters when first they put the name of king upon me and bade them speak to him. Then prophet-like they hailed him father to a line of kings. Upon my head they placed a fruitless crown, no son of mine succeeding. If it be so, for Banquo's issue have I filed my mind. For them, the gracious Duncan, have I murdered, put rancors in the vessel of my peace, only for them, and mine eternal jewel given to the common enemy of man to make them kings, the seed of Banquo kings. Rather than so, come fate into the list and champion me to the utterance. Who's there?
Now go to the door and stay there till we call.
Was it not yesterday we spoke together?
Do us so please, Your Highness.
Well, then, now, have you considered of my speeches? Know that it was he in the times past which held you so under fortune which you thought had been our innocent self. This I made known to you in our last conference, passed in probation with you, how you were born in hand, how crossed, the instruments who wrought with him, and all things else that might to have a soul into a notion crazed, say, thus did Banquo.
You made it known to us.
I did. And went further, which is now our point of second meeting. Do you find your patience so predominant in your nature that you can let this go? Are you so gospeled to pray for this good man and his issue, whose heavy hand hath bowed you to the grave and beggared yours forever?
We are men, my liege.
In the catalogue you go for men, as hounds and greyhounds, mongrels, spaniels, curs, shots, water rugs, and demigods are called all by the name of dogs. The valued file distinguishes the slow, the swift, the subtle, the housekeeper, the hunter. Everyone according to the gift which bounteous nature hath in him closed, whereby he doth receive particular addition from the bill that writes them all alike. And so of men. Now, if you have a station in the file, not in the worst rank of manhood, say it. And I will put that business in your bosom whose execution takes your enemy off, grapples you to the heart and love of us, who wear our health but sickly in his life, which in his death were perfect.
I am one, my liege. The vile blows and buffets of the world have so incensed, I am reckless what I do to spite the world.
And I another, so weary with disasters, tugged with fortune, that I would set my life on any chance to mend it or be rid on it.
Both of you know Banquo is your enemy.
True, my lord.
True, my lord.
So is he mine. And though I could with barefaced power sweep him from my sight and bid my will avouch it, yet I must not. For certain friends that are both his and mine, whose loves I may not drop, but wail his fall, who I myself struck down. Thence it is that I, to your acquaintance, do make love, masking the business from the common eye for sundry weighty reasons.
It shall, my lord, be done as you command it.
Though our lives will be...
Your spirits shine through you. Within the hour at most, I will advise you where to plant yourselves. The moment on it, for it must be done tonight. In something from the palace. Think, always I desire a clearness. And with him, to leave no rubs nor botches in the work. Phleon's his son that goes with him, whose absence is no less material to me than is his father's, must embrace the fate of that dark hour. Resolve yourselves apart. I'll come to you anon.
We are resolved, my lord.
We are resolved, my lord.
I'll call. call upon you. Strength! Abide within. It is concluded. Banquo, thy soul's flight, if it find heaven, must find it out tonight.
Is Banquo gone from court?
Aye, madam, but returns again tonight.
Say to the king, I would attend his leisure for a few words.
Madam, I will.
Naught's had. All is spent. For our desire is got without content. 'Tis safer then to be that which we destroy, and by destruction dwell in doubtful joy. How now, my lord? Why do you keep alone, of sorriest fancies your companions making, using those thoughts which indeed should have died with them they think on? Things without all remedy should be without regard. What's done is done.
We have scotched the snake, not killed it. She'll close and be herself again, whilst our poor malice lies in danger of her former tooth. But let the frame of things disjoint. Both the worlds suffer. Oh, we will eat our meal in fear and sleep in the affliction of these terrible dreams that shake us nightly. Better be with the dead, whom we, to gain our peace, have sent to peace, than on the torture of the mind to lie in restless ecstasy. Duncan's in his grave. After life's fitful fever, he sleeps well. Treason has done his worst. Nor steel, nor poison, malice domestic, foreign levy, nothing can touch him further.
Come on, gentle my lord. Sleek o'er your rugged looks. Be bright and jovial amongst our guests tonight.
So shall I love, and so I pray be you. Let your remembrance apply to Banquo. Present him eminence, both with eye and tongue. Unsafe the while that we must bathe our honors in these flattering streams and make our faces visage to our hearts, disguising what they are.
You must leave this.
Full of scorpions is my mind, dear wife. Thou knowest Banquo and his fleance live.
But in them nature's copy is not eterne.
There's comfort yet. They are assailable. And be thou jocund. Ere the bat hath flown his cloistered flight, ere to black Hecate summons, the shard-born beetle with his drowsy hums hath wrung night's yawning peal, there shall be done a deed of dreadful note.
What's to be done?
Be innocent of the knowledge, dearest Chalk, till thou applaud the deed.
sealing night. Scarf up the tender eye of pitiful day, in which thy bloody and invisible hand cancel and tear to pieces that great bond which keeps me pale.
Light thickens, and the crow makes wing to the rooky wood. Good things of day begin to droop and drowse, whilst night's black agents to their prey do rouse. Thou marvelest at my words, but hold thee still. Things bad begun make strong themselves by ill. So prithee, go with me.
Join with us.
Macbeth.
He needs not our mistrust.
Standish. The west yet glimmers with some streaks of day, and near approaches the subject of our watch.
Give us a light there. Ho!
A light. A light!
Stand to see.
It'll be rain tonight.
Let it come down.
Oh! Treachery! Fly, Confliance! Fly! 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 Ow! Bloody! Ow!
Did it cut out the light?
That's not the way. That's what went down. The sun has fled.
We lost. Best half of our affair.
Well, it's away and say how much is done.